There's something about native grasses. We've noticed it. John Stafford's got it. Sean Kennedy's got it. When you wake up at 2 o'clock in the morning, 3 o'clock in the morning, and you're thinking about native grasses, you've got it. When that doesn't happen to you, you haven't got it yet. So as has already been said, I work for the Upper Torrens Land Management Project, and this project on, you know, the privilege to be able to be the project officer for it, it's amazing. Native Grass Resources Group, couldn't be doing it without them, Ellen, Bob. I've got to say thank you to these people. Like, the money comes from the Biodiversity Fund, from the Australian government, but the people that are involved, it's not just me, it's everybody from the community right through to John Stafford, Sean Kennedy, all these people. I just want to confuse things a little bit more. The Upper Torrens Land Management Project is, so my money comes from the federal government. I work for the Upper Torrens Land Management Project. The Barossa Council employs me, and the Adelaide Hills Council pays the bills. So, who do I work for? I don't know. I've just got to take credit for that picture. That's why I can't do it. It does not suit our environment, and it is something that we haven't done on any of our broadacre sites, even though it was brilliant. It was so good. It was just, we can't do it. Our environment, oh, we've got another one. We've got sugar. Do you want to see sugar? This is a good one. So the sugar gets added after. And I don't know if any of you know about sugar. Quite effectively stops things growing. So every 3 months we added another dose of sugar. So we bought a ton of the stuff, and that was interesting to handle. And now we got lots of canisters. So, although the scout worked, I think using the sugar you might have germination, but because of locking up the nutrients, they just died. Everything died. And then once the sugar had depleted in the system, then all of a sudden all the weeds and the weed species came back. Oh, another one. I've got to shake this. I'm sure this you'll see why in a second. I should have counted how many I've chosen. Mulch is really good in the first few months of holding everything back. Letting the natives through. Obviously, we've got some broadleaf weeds in there. As you get more and more rainfall, which is what happened this year. There we go. Now that, on these two sites, actually at least three properties that this is on, there is nothing on their properties that's as good as this. The clover is almost a foot high. The brome and the oats are, you know, standing up here, and you cannot see any natives. You can see a little bit of canisters, but it's huge. It is the amount of biomass just from adding composted pine meat. So it was sterile, there was no weed seed in it. The nutrients that it's added to the soil, the site's pretty low nutrients. It's unbelievable what it's done. So if you're going to use something that's going to add nutrients to a site, don't do it. Right, this is the only graph I'm going to show you, and there's a couple of reasons why. First of all, this shows a loss in biodiversity on a whole, a loss in biodiversity across all the sites, all the plots over the span of 3 years, with a couple of exceptions. You can see the scalp and sugar in the top graph, in the middle there. The exotic species on the left, the very first column, very low, and obviously because we know why, we've removed the topsoil, we've taken the weed seed, and we've added sugar, so nothing can really germinate and grow. But on a whole, all the exotics are booming in all of them compared to the native. I've got something else I wanted to say here. The difference between those two, between the first graph and the second graph, the second graph at the bottom there had chemical failure for 3 years. Obviously, it's got weeds. We didn't think there'd be so many weeds, but after a chemical failure, it did greatly reduce the exotic species. I don't really want to talk too much about that now. we're getting down to the most important thing, because we can't have topsoil removal. So let's just throw that out the window for now. It's all about weed control. You can have 10 grams of seed, you can have 10 kilos of seed. If you don't control the weeds, all you've got is a weed problem. So the weed problem doesn't just start with, yes, it starts with site preparation, but it also goes into management. We're not talking about management. So the most important thing, everything else, like it says there, I think this started with Ian Shippers, was the first person that said to me, 95% weed control, you're going to have fun without topsoil removal. And it's true, we've had a lot of fun. Top weeds, whether it be chemicals, whether it be physical removal, whatever it is, weeds are the problem. Absolutely, we've been doing it for a few years now, and if there was no weeds, it would be brilliant. Like, we all know that if you put something in a garden, or if you put your veggies in, if you don't have to do weed control, you have to mess with the veggies. So herbicide, like, as much as I don't like herbicide, there's another thing that we don't like herbicide. It's a friend. What we want to do is get to a point where we don't have to use herbicide. So if we start using herbicide, say you might use it in your site preparation, and then might use it after emergence in the first bit of time, but then it's disturbance mainly that produces your huge flush. In your seeding event, you're going to get a huge flush. With our machine, we're disturbing. We're actually working on a second machine, which is low disturbance, but our primary machine is from the same as the man, Paul Gibson Roy, 100 mil disturbance with the barrel tines on the aerobator. So you're disturbing right down the soil profile. I'm not turning it over, it's just cracking it, fracturing it, and just making it all nicely aerated. So if you've got a nice soil crust, you can actually go over and then get out of the tractor and have a look, and you've still got your soil crust, it's just being fractured up and broken. So it's not actually turning over your soil. But it's encouraging all your weeds to grow. We go onto sites and we look at, this is a beautiful site, look at this, it's only got this weed, brilliant, let's go in, it's just got oats. Wipe out the oats, we think a couple of years of that, excellent. We're on top of it, we've got no weeds. We sow it, and it's completely covered wall to wall in the rhodium. Oh, where was that? It was sitting in there, and we disturbed it. We go to the right environment, and away it goes. Doesn't necessarily mean the piece of machinery that you've used has created that for it. All it takes is a disturbance. So if you've burnt it, up onto your rhodium. You've herbicide it, up onto your rhodium. You do something, and I'm just using a rhodium as an example. But radio in our area is probably the worst one. I see herbicide as a friend. I see it as something we have to use, but with the long-term goal of not using herbicide. We don't want to use herbicide. It's a poison. Talking about herbicide, this lovely piece of machinery there, the Roto Wiper, I'm not advertising it, but it's a great piece of machinery for New Zealand. This is it. Before I started, I thought I'd just take a photo. This is in Cromer. We've seeded this site. It's completely covered in. I've morphed into management. Anyway, I'll stay on this really quickly. It's mainly because it's about chemicals. We've sown this site with 60-odd species. At the moment, this was sown this year. I wiped it about 3 weeks ago. Oh no, time flies. 2 months ago. completely covered. That is all ryegrass. Oh yeah, that's good. So I needed to wipe it. Now the native grasses, 3 weeks beforehand, Anthony and I were out there, he's the ecologist, and I know the native grasses as well, and we were down there on our hands and knees, seeing crassula and a whole heap of other things, as well as all the ryegrass obviously. We did not see the native grasses. 3 weeks later, and it was 3 weeks, time didn't fly this time. And I got there with this machine, and the native grasses are sitting there about an inch high. And even some of them started putting up their palms. So I was like, because I wanted to set this as low as I could go so that I could get all of the ryegrass. So this machine, you have a little button on your quad bike, if you're allowed to use quads. Ready? All right, so you can control the height of this machine, you can wipe through the sides, and bang. All of that, 2 weeks later, well, actually after a few days, it started browning off. Using a higher rate, you're targeting it at the plants only, and you're killing them. You're not spraying on the soil, you're not spraying on anything else, it's purely just being wiped over the species that you want to attack. You can set it high, you can set it to a nice height above your natives, a foot high, a bit higher. You can go right down to the ground. This, in the first year, is allowing the natives to establish properly. If you look through where it's really thick, you can hardly see them. If they are there, they are so small. You walk out into the open areas, and they're actually getting quite decent plants. Knocking this off, all of a sudden they've got some light, they've already got moisture because it's saturated. And bang, they start growing. But we need to get rid of these, because if this drops seed, we heard it like yesterday, as soon as your weeds drop seed, that's the end of it. You're in a cycle. This is another site, same thing, I wiped it. There you go. You've got, in the open spaces, you've got the native grasses. In where it's thick with ryegrass, you haven't. They're just not there. It's been sown exactly the same. That's another site that just has selective herbicide. So let's just move on. Another site that I have used a selective herbicide. On the left-hand side, yes, I think it's pretty good. You can see in the middle there, there's a section through the middle there that I've used a selective herbicide on. And yes, we've got some capeweed, but we've got very minimal erodium. And this, I'm just giving you examples of, it's your friend. I've literally gone through there and gone, oh, I'll just test this chemical. And obviously using the rates on the label. And I've got results that, in this picture, the wild birds through that strip are gone. Even though I wasn't targeting them, but they were. Seeding rates. If you can get 50 kilos, put in 50 kilos. If you have only got 10, put in 10. I know it's expensive, and unfortunately I'm not looking at it from an expense point of view because we grow our own seed. This little site, it's not a broadacre site, it's only, 500 square metres or something. 60 kilos a hectare. There is not a square centimetre for anything to grow other than the volume that's growing. And that's its second year now, and it's just a brilliant sword. Now we just use that for seed production. 40 kilos a hectare. There's a range of native grasses in there. I've seen these a little bit sweet. And you've also got Arthropodium and a few other species that are coming up as well. And that's only, we sowed that last year, I think. 12 kilos a hectare. Obviously, this isn't saying this is what it's going to look like with this amount of kilos, because every site can be different. The viability will start coming into a whole different thing. This is just what we've come up with. 12 kilos a hectare, so that's pretty good. A lot of open space. Let's get into quickly into seed production. All of our seed production areas, generally speaking, are all on weed mat. And the reason they're on weed mat is for more than one reason. One reason being, there's me, and there could be a contractor if I get them, but there's me. How am I going to go and harvest all of these different seed production areas at the same time, if they are ready at the same time? I'm not. So, we've got a barrier around the outside and we've got plastic on the bottom, so it just drops on the ground and I go and get it when I'm ready. I can harvest with the brush harvester, the grass grabber that we've all seen yesterday, and then I go through with a poo bag. You saw that on Alice's, it's a greystone horse poo bag. The seeds don't go through the motor, they just get sucked straight into the area rather than going through the blades of the motor. Because with wallaby, that separates the seed from the flora, or at least it can. So the main reason there you go. The seed drops on the ground, I can back it up. If I'm on another site, even if a really hot day comes and everything drops, I'm sure Chris has had experience with all of a sudden something happens and it's part of it's dropped and it's just like, oh, we've lost part of it. I haven't lost part of it, but I've only got little seed production areas. The biggest one I've got is 90 metres by 40 metres. That's the biggest, and then the rest of them are gradually smaller. Then at the Barossa Bush Gardens, we've got all of our herbs and forms out there, and sand trenches and foam boxes. We've got a couple of pictures. Here's one of the seed production areas. This is, again, that same size as this one. We've got Anthosacne and Bristol's Philogenic Glass. Sorry, I'm sticking to the real names. Federal government will hate me if I start using that name. I'm not waiting for that.
How much production per year, Andrew?
In total of all of our seeds, it's about 400-450 kilos. There we've got a Senecio species. On the right-hand side, up the top, unfortunately I've got a good photo of it, but that's Senecio sclerosus, the one that people mistake for South African daisy. So they've taken South African daisy off the declare list, or at least they did, because people were killing that instead, and that is a threatened species. So we're growing that in quite a kilo, like masses of kilos. Just some vitidinia.
One minute.
Just a little bit of vitidinia. That produces around 70, 80 kilos a year. And if you 70, 80 kilos would cover this whole floor. There we have the brachyscome, which is a poplar, an endangered species in our area. Aringium vesiculosa, an endangered species. So we're getting masses of seed from all these, and it's not really a huge, it's a pretty big area, but it's not that big. It's, you know, people have got these sorts of size of things happening in their nurseries, whether it be land care in their even backyard. You have 10 fine boxes of something, you can end up with a kilo or two seed of something that you started off with this much seed. We might start talking about there could be genetic problems with that, but what we do is we get a bit from here, a bit from there, a bit from there, a bit from there, while they're all put into a nursery and into a seed production. There it goes. Seed production, where's it going? Well, that's really good, don't I? The Mid-North grassland management, we had Paul Gibson Roy a couple of weeks ago on Skype from wherever he lives, Sydney. He's just come back from America like we heard yesterday. I just want to leave you with a couple of things. This is all from Paul, so this isn't from me, this is from Paul. Lady Bird Johnston in 1965, basically and her husband, they started the Highway Beautification Act to be passed in America. From there to now, I read on their website yesterday in Oregon, $228,464,000 was a low year for hot native grass sales in Oregon. $228 million. 23.8 million acres of grassland restoration. 23.8 million acres. 800,000 kilometres of roadsides. And $2 billion a year gets put in by the government. How much gets put in by philanthropy, we don't know, and commercial, we don't know. $2 billion gets put in by the government to help seed production and people growing seed and purchasing seed. But the way it is in America is it's not packaged for biodiversity and conservation, it's packaged for roads and beauty. This is fantastic, it looks great. The tourists love it, the people love it. We need to do something. I know we want conservation, biodiversity, and all that sort of thing. But the greater public and the rest of the country, they don't care about what we care about. Some do, not many. We need to get there some way or another, like America's done. They've done it. I don't like following America with many things, but this thing would be good. If we could get people to be enthusiastic about the natives because of what they look like and how we could end up making our roadsides, even though we've got narrow little roadsides, but it's a start. And he talked about, we asked him over Skype, we said, what's the seeding rate in America? It's between 20 and 50 kilos per hectare. Now they've got masses of experience, they've been doing this for a long time, so that's what they do, between 20 and 50 kilos per hectare. I don't really have to say this again because my time's up, but it's 95% weed control and 5% everything else. But just remember those things that I said, that list there. It is just so important. Because if you go into something and you don't take these things into consideration, you're either going to fail, you're going to be disgruntled, there's going to be problems. And you just need to wait. We've got sites from 2 years ago, and we're going, are they going to come up yet? And I'll speak to them, they'll come up to that. And they do. They are actually coming up, so just wait. Be patient. That's all I've got.